Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Kathleen, for your introduction, a very thorough CV. And I was horrified to think I had been here for 20 years, but it's not all that far off. And thank you, Mary, for inviting me to talk here today. It's been a fascinating morning so far, and I hope I can kind of continue and add to that. When Mary invited me to speak at this conference, she caught me just as I'd announced that I was going to be leaving my current position as director of the IFI to take up the role of director of IMA in April. And my immediate response to the request to talk at a conference about the future of museums was that my thinking was still very much at that point of transition of moving from one kind of cultural institution, the Irish Film Institute, which isn't a museum, to move back into a museum world as director of IMA. And that whatever presentation I gave would be very reflective of this strange point of transition that I find myself in now, slightly schizophrenic, where you're still very much immersed in one organisation that you're working in, but beginning to think about the new role that I'm going to take up in April. And I thought that perhaps the key issues I could most usefully address in this context would be the ways in which the experience I've gained from running the Irish Film Institute may be useful and inform my new role as director of a museum of modern art. Until I took up the position of the director in the IFI, my career up until that point had very much been as a curator and a director working in almost entirely in public funded galleries. And that meant my experience had been working in environments that operated with fairly fixed financial models, with a large reliance on public subsidy that was then supplemented by additional funding thought through fundraising and some commercial income streams. Audience participation and attendance is, of course, very important to these organisations, but crucially, is not critical to their financial stability. The Irish Film Institute, and this is the IFI, and I'm sure many of you know it, but for those of you who are not familiar with it, it's Ireland's national cultural institution for film. We have three core activities. The exhibition of film, which is delivered through our three cinemas here in Temple Bar, and nationally with various partners. IFI Education, which is a nationwide programme for school children throughout Ireland, and Preservation, with a home of the Irish Film Archive, which holds and makes accessible Ireland's moving image heritage, which is currently about 25,000 cans of film and 10,000 tapes. We're funded by the Arts Council, currently at a level of 760,000 a year, and this represents 26% of the 2.8 million that it costs us to deliver our core programs. That's not our turnover, but the actual cost of delivering our programs in those three key areas to exhibit, preserve, and educate. The Arts Council's 26% is the only funding that's guaranteed at the start of the year, or now April or March as things have moved on. And that remaining 74% has to be generated through our various income streams, box office, cafe bar, retail, membership, and programming partnerships and sponsorships. And this reliance on earned income was the thing that I found most difficult about making the transition from working in galleries to being director of the IFI. And it's probably the one thing, if I'm really honest about, that I hadn't thought about enough when I made that transition. That financial model is not at all unusual for performing venues, but coming from a gallery background, I found that reliance on earned income quite terrifying and quite difficult to deal with initially. But it really forced me to broaden my thinking and question how I see myself as a director of a cultural organisation. It's challenged me to see that role as having a much broader scope and remit than just programme. And most crucially, I think, has forced me to really engage with income generation and audience in ways that I hadn't really done before. But as I'm about to finish at the IFI, I can see that this experience that I've gained from working in a slightly different context to the museum and galleries that I've worked in before has had real relevance to what I see as some of the main concerns that face museums right now. I mean, firstly, in terms of the acute financial difficulties that all publicly funded institutions now face, and the need has already been mentioned today for museums to find new, inventive, and flexible ways to generate income. And secondly, the challenge that I see facing museums to be relevant and responsive to their audience, the people who fund them. There is a responsibility and accountability that comes from running a publicly funded organisation, and museums need to adapt to the changing dynamics of society and meet the changing expectations of their audiences, something all the speakers have spoken about this morning. Put simply, they need to be places that people want to go to, want to connect to, and see as an integral part of the society within which they live. I think there's a danger in Ireland at the moment with the increasing emphasis on the role that our major public institutions play in attracting cultural tourism, that our home audience can be a little bit overlooked in terms of cultural policy. But I think it's this more engaged, permanent connection with the society that we're all operating in which defines us and the institutions that we work in. So I'm going to focus my talk today on these two areas, the importance of enterprise and audience to cultural institutions. The IFI, like everybody, I'm sure in the room who works in a publicly funded arts organisation at the moment, we've seen a substantial decline in public funding since 2009, in total a 20% decline that equates to just over 200,000. So in response to this, I identified with the board that we needed to find new income streams to the tune of about 300,000 if we were going to be able to continue to deliver our programmes at the level that we already were, and also crucially to be able to develop. Sponsorship is the first option that we thought about, but that's a lot of money to raise in this climate. It's very ambitious. It can take a lot of effort with no guaranteed return, and film is not always the easiest thing to attract a sponsor to. Or we could look at our own income streams and ensure that these were delivering in the best possible way. We don't have the resources in the IFI to do both, so we decided the likelihood of bigger returns was to concentrate on our internal income streams. The IFI is in what can be seen as an unfortunate, but I think is actually very fortunate, position of running all areas of our operation. So that means the cafe and the shop are not franchised out, but are managed by us internally and come under my remit. The IFI is very reliant on box office to deliver the income it needs. We still have every year we have a mildly terrifying target of 1 million to achieve in box office. But we don't program on a commercial basis, and we didn't want to look to box office to be the way to generate further income. So one of the first stages was to identify within the IFI the things that we do that are purely to make money. The cafe bar, which I'm sure you're familiar with, facilities hire, and the film shop. And we rebranded them as IFI enterprises. This meant separating them out in the accounts and showing them only in terms of the net contribution they make to the IFI's core costs. We changed the staff structure and the board structure to reflect this. There's now a subcommittee on the board that's dedicated to our enterprise income streams, and the staffing structure is now divided into three key areas: program, public affairs, and operations, with operations having a very particular focus on maintaining the amount of income we get from our enterprises. When we started to do this, it caused a lot of debate with the board and the staff. As a publicly funded organisation, were we distracting ourselves from our key cultural aims by dedicating time and resources to developing the commercial side of our organisation, something we've always kind of publicly quite downplayed? And would we be vulnerable to cuts in public funding as if we were seen as being too commercial, or that dreaded phase as a publicly funded organisation that makes too much money? But I think the argument should and could be framed in another way. We describe the IFI as operating a model of cultural enterprise, and by that we mean we utilise our commercial opportunities in order to subsidise and support our core activities to exhibit, to preserve, and to educate. And we've made a feature of this to the audience. I mean, slightly kind of bluntly and simplistically, we ran a campaign of, if you have an IFI burger, you're supporting our education programme. As I say, it's a simplistic message, but one is that's very true. And I think framed in this way, you could argue that we'd be negligent not to focus on these areas, that we have a responsibility to assure that their effective management allows us to not cut or diminish our core activities. And in this period of severe cuts in public funding, we haven't cut our activities, we've grown them. And when we started this process, the more detailed financial analysis of our shop and cafe in particular threw up a very disturbing picture that actually the IFI had been very negligent. Although a lack of proper commercial focus meant that although the shop and cafe had been busy and on the surface performing well, they'd actually been losing the IFI money. And that became evident when we did the simple exercise of separating out the net costs against the actual income, and putting against that the staff costs and profit margins and the pricing structure, and really looking at detail about what these parts of the IFI's activities were actually really contributing to our finances. And what had been happening is that there hadn't been that kind of proper focus on that. None of these areas and kind of stuff, thinking about profit margins, staff costs, had really been tested or looked at in forensic detail, and not in any way tested against industry norms. And in many ways, this is not at all surprising. The IFI is a cultural organisation that has a board and staff that largely come from a cultural rather than a business background. And as director, I was not in any way equipped to address this issue. But with the board, agreed that we should invest in outside expertise and that that initial investment would be essential and pay off in the long term. It did. For example, an investment of $5,000 that we paid to restaurant and retail consultants has led to an increase of over $200,000 in net profit over the last 2 years, and that, as I say, has directly gone in to support our programme. And importantly, it's given us a proper framework to make sure that these areas are properly managed in the future and that margins are maintained and that decisions on stock and menus are commercially based. And while the shop can add to an overall experience of the IFI, I think it's very, we always remind ourselves it's not what we're funded to do. It's not our core activity. So decisions we make about how this operates are purely commercial and not cultural. Similarly with the bar. I mean, it's nice to have a nice cafe within the organisation. You think of the famous kind of V&A campaign of nice cafe with a museum attached. We do not think of ourselves as a nice cafe with a cultural organisation attached. It's important that the cafe functions well, but it is what we do. It's the importance of it to us is the way in which it enables us to deliver our programme and protect our programme. I mean, a very clear example of that. When we were looking at our French Film Festival, which was one of the bigger programmes we deliver each year, we lost a core sponsor, and there was a very big issue around our ability to deliver that programme. The one thing we didn't want to do was change the programme to attract more box office by making the programme more mainstream, less challenging, less critical. So we had to find another way of supporting that. So we looked to the cafe, and we really marketed the cafe alongside the festival with a special French menu. A simple thing, but it generated an extra 15,000 during the festival into an income return, and that made up for the loss of the sponsor. I'm not going to bore you with the details of our commercial operations, but I suppose I wanted to just raise a wider point about how institutions can respond to the financial crisis and reductions in subsidy. There's a growing focus at policy level in Ireland to grow the base for philanthropy as a means to support the arts, and this is, of course, very, very important. But I think we also need to recognise, and I think it probably isn't recognised enough here, the fact that many cultural organisations have a strong enterprise aspect to their activities, and the ability to maximise income from internal resources should not be overlooked. And that strong business acumen within the organisation does not undermine its cultural validity. It actually strengthens it. And it's something that's going to have to become more and more important to the viability of many organisations. When I started the IFI in 2008, it was facing a number of threats to its ability to maintain audience. Digital cinema meant that titles that had previously been exclusive to the IFI were now in multiple cinemas throughout Dublin, and the cinema landscape was changing with more cinemas opening up and then closing again and opening up again. And whereas the IFI had previously been in a position of just showing a film and the audience came to us, we now had to give people a reason to come, to choose the IFI over other venues, and to continue to make that choice. This began as a financial imperative. As I say, the IFI cannot exist without high visitor numbers, and that financial reality is always there for us. But it became more than that. It really became about defining the IFI as a centre of film culture, a unique place that offers many different ways in which the audience can engage with us and our programme, and one that film lovers in Dublin would want to be part of. And since 2009, we've seen an audience increase of 20%, and also, crucially for us, an increase in membership of 16%, and considering that kind of coincides with the financial crisis, we're kind of very proud of that growth. We've approached this in three ways. By ensuring the primacy of the visitor experience, by creating through membership and our communication strategy a wider sense of a film community whose connection to the IFI extends beyond their visits to the building, and a consideration of audience in all our programming. Who is the program for? Are there people out there who might enjoy what we're doing who aren't hearing about it? Are we clearly communicating what it's about, why we're doing it? And are there ways we can create a more porous relationship between the IFI programmes and our audience? The primacy of the visitor experience may sound like a very obvious thing, but it's something that I think should never be overlooked. People's time is precious. If they invest that time in coming to your organisation, it needs to be pleasurable and rewarding. Are the simple things like, are the staff polite? Is the information clear? Are the facilities okay? I think you cannot overemphasize the importance of clean toilets. And as the director of the one organization in Dublin, I think has the busiest toilets. It's something I think about daily. When you're there, can you have a nice cup of coffee? Can you change your baby's nappy? Is there a child seat for your toddler? Do your opening hours work? Do the opening hours of your institution work for your audience, or in our case, the timings of the film? I mean, after about a year after I'd been at the IFI, I asked the programmers why we programmed a lot of films at 5:30 rather than 6. And I was given the answer that it was because if people really wanted to see the film, they'd leave work early. Which, you know, is very revealing. It may be true in the 80s, certainly not true now. We've also seen that people don't want to go out so late at the moment. I think people are working harder. 6:30 is a much busier slot for us. We're adapting our program to that. And it just shows that old habits within an organization die hard unless they're really challenged. None of this is rocket science, as I say, but I think you'll all acknowledge that in the business of delivering program, dealing with funders, just keeping an organization afloat, it can get very easily overlooked. But it's essential that this is kept at the forefront of day-to-day planning and the running of the building. The relaunch of the IFI membership and accompanying loyalty card has been central to our ability to grow and keep audience. Now, cinema offers a very good model for maximizing these kind of schemes because we can offer real benefits and in terms of free tickets and discounts. But the way that we marketed it, I think, was very important. It was very much about rewarding and benefiting our audience, being part of the IFI community. It wasn't positioned as a support mechanism for the IFI. And the price point at €25 or €15 is low enough to be very accessible to all our visitors. Members are not just an important income generator, and we've now got about 9,000 members. But they provide you with a core audience who you can communicate directly with. We have their information. They're interested in what they do. They come a lot. We know that on average, IFI members come 2 or 3 times a month. And they can be very powerful advocates for the organization. And we see them, therefore, as a very, very important resource. And one of the most surprising aspects to me of our relaunch membership was our best member scheme, which we launched at the much higher price point of €99. And we now have 240 best members. One of the benefits of this scheme is an invitation to a social event with other best members and to meet the IFI programmers. We tell them what we're doing, we give tours of the archive, and generally it's just a chance for a discussion about film. The members we have, and this is a surprise to me, are not high earners. They're retired, many are unemployed, they're nurses, teachers, some of the people who've been hardest hit in recent times. But what's interesting in talking to them is that they all seem to have joined in order to be part of a group, to feel that connection with an organization, and a group through which they can further an interest in cinema, find out more, and remarkably, I sort of say this very honestly, they see it as very, very good value, which was not the group at all we imagined when we launched that scheme. Social networking, of course, has increasingly been recognized as a vital tool for cultural organizations to communicate with their audience. And we've, acknowledging that, we've recently made the move of creating a special post within marketing just directly to address this. But it is something that needs to be managed and strategized. Without that, it just can be, if it's badly used, it becomes ineffective white noise. And I'm by no means an expert on this, and I have to confess I'm not a very active user of Facebook or Twitter. But I can absolutely see its potential as more than just an information tool in which to kind of post notices of what we're doing or to advertise our events. It's a space in which an organization can stimulate a level of critical debate and engagement about their programs or just generally wider cultural issues. And to maintain an ongoing connection and sense of greater engagement with an audience. For us, you'll see up there, I think our Facebook community is now at 14,000. And this is something we'll be really using a lot. We're coming up to, in September, the IFI celebrating its 20th anniversary. We're going to be using social media as a very powerful tool within that to gather memories about the IFI, whether that's a great first date that people had there, and coming back to the idea of a cultural organizations as social spaces, to films that people saw that transformed their lives. But the Facebook, Twitter, our blog, our website, we're going to be using as a space really to gather a picture of what the IFI means to our audience. There's our Twitter. In terms of talking about consideration of audience in our programme, I don't mean by that putting on programmes that we know will easily attract high audience numbers. That's an easy route to go, and while we do need to achieve high box office results, we aim to do this within a broad and diverse programme of cultural cinema that's not always immediately accessible and can be very challenging to audiences. And within that, we're very realistic about the size of audiences that some films are ever likely to attract. But we do think about how this programme is framed and communicated to the audience. If we think something is important for us to show, are we making this evidence to people? And this can be done in a number of ways, from blogs, from staff recommendations within the programme, a director's note that I write at the start of each month in the monthly programme framing, introducing the audience to the programme, framing it, pointing out highlights, reviews that are posted on Twitter. These are all simple things that don't cost and can reach a very large audience. And then, of course, we also run talks and lectures for those that really want to engage further. But for us, key to all of this, increasingly, is foregrounding the voice and position of the IFI staff, explaining our programming decisions and inviting a debate with our audience about that, and generally creating and acknowledging our position as a cultural organisation as one that is not fixed, it's shifting, it's contested, and it's open to interpretation. One of our more successful initiatives in this area is The Critical Take, a monthly discussion event where three nominated films are discussed by IFI programmes and invited panellists, and very deliberately and most often these are not film experts. And this is now attracting a kind of average audience of about 60 a month. The sessions are very deliberately informal. They're not about the IFI passing on knowledge, but about a joint discussion that we have with our audience about a shared experience of programme. And the audience have a huge amount to say, and it's created a really useful space for us to hear about their responses to the programme, and also for the audience to meet and hear from our programmers. We've also looked at very closely at the different types of entry points we offer into the programme. These range from the formal lectures to directors' interviews, evening courses, to much more informal talks, down to very brief introductions, contextualising the film. Not everybody wants to go to a formal lecture, but a lot of people do want to find ways to engage and find out more. And many of the events that we run do not directly address cinema, but touch on the kind of wider cultural issues that our programme affects. For example, we had a very lively and heated programme of discussions around the pipe of documentary we showed about the current pipeline that directly addressed that issue of a very big issue within Ireland. And broadly, when a programme is decided upon, we then ask, how are we going to make this accessible to our audience? And how are we going to improve their experience of it? Does it need to be contextualised? And if so, how should this be done? And this isn't something that's just done by the education department. It's a thinking that runs across the whole programming team. We also closely monitor our audience patterns. When are people coming and who are coming at particular times? And this is constantly shifting. And so our program needs to respond to this. For example, this year we've seen a much bigger attendance, and I'm sure all of you probably are, during the afternoon. Remarkable, you know, it was very evident even in February with the 8,000 public servants taking early retirement, our audience numbers went up in the afternoon. So we've now started doing mid-afternoon talks, something we wouldn't have ever done before. And similarly, we've been using lunchtimes more and more for free programmes for archive material, such as shorts, like the Oscar-winning short, the one for The Shore that won the Oscar recently. And this was in response to a very successful drive we'd done in thinking about the restaurant more to get people to come in and have lunch and eat their lunch in the IFI, but then we realised they weren't going to the cinema. So we offered these free cinema programmes as a way of combining the two, but crucially, nothing in the cinema is ever 20 minutes long, so you can do both. And of course, we have programmes aimed at specific audience groups, such as our World Strawberries, which is a very active over 55 film club, IFI family, and we're currently trying to build up our out-of-schools teen club. Now, these are just some of the examples of the kind of things we've tried to develop. We've tried to develop the audience for our programmes, and a lot of this is trial and error, and I'm by no means proposing a template of how cultural organisations can do this. Little of this is unique, and strategies such as this can be seen in the public programmes offered by the range of excellent organisations we have in Ireland and, of course, internationally. I'm also very conscious in talking about this that audiences have a very particular relationship with film that doesn't necessarily extend to other art forms, and in many ways this can make our job a lot easier. But I suppose what I'm offering is a reflection of how a financial imperative within the organisation has developed within the IFI a very heightened and responsive awareness of audience and how they experience what we do and the things we've learned in trying different ways and developing different ways in which they can be encouraged to engage with us. But of course, central to all of this is the programme and our three core aims to exhibit, educate and preserve. We do not define our success by the number of likes we have on Facebook or the number of members we have, but by the quality of the programmes that we deliver, the effect the films we screen have on our audience. This is a very random selection of recent titles, Green Wave. And I didn't title them just to test you. Shame, Orson Welles' Touch of Evil, Green Wave, an amazing documentary animation we showed about the revolution in Iran. What is most important to us is the quality of the programmes deliver and the effect that the films that we show have on our audience, whether that's a large audience or a small audience, and the films that we save and preserve within the Irish Film Archive. This is Guess the Nation, which is a film, amazing silent film from the 1935 made by Dennis Johnson about the Civil War. We restored the film, commissioned a new score, and it was presented at the National Concert Hall with live orchestral accompaniment. Actually, just going back, these are just examples of some of our events, a random Daniel Day-Lewis picture, because it's always nice to look at Daniel Day-Lewis, in conversation with Hugh O'Connor, Kirsten and Jim Sheridan, Costa Gravis doing a Skype, director of Missing, doing a Skype interview with Conor Horgan. I mean, this is what we are about. I don't want to give the impression that, you know, this isn't to the fore of what we do. Crucial to our work is the extraordinary introduction to cinema, the introduction to extraordinary cinema. We provide 20,000 school children across the county each year. These are some images from our family festival, which happens every July, an animation workshop with Chris Judge, who is the author of The Lonely Beast. Those of you with small children will know that book. Image from a screening. We had a special screening of Cars with the director of Cars came over, and there was a Q&A with under 6-year-olds, which was interesting. And then a graffiti workshop that was done in response to Werner Herzog's 3D film, Cave of Forgotten Dreams. Now, I'll explain this image in a moment. As I say, for all museums and cultural organisations, it's this primacy of the cultural experience. I'm going to take that image back, actually, too early. For all museums and cultural organisations, it's the primacy of the cultural experience that we offer that drives what we do and makes the potential we hold within society so potent. Put very simply, it's not all about burgers and toilets. And I've put that image up more as a kind of personal joke to myself, because some days you can lose sight of that and feel like it is all about burgers and toilets. And I've had moments when I wonder why I did art history, to spend so much time worrying about how many chips go on a plate to make the right margin. But I suppose the point I want to make, and the sort of more serious point underlining, that the strategies I've discussed here should in no way dominate or overrun the core objectives of the programme. And keeping that balance, I think, is one of the very difficult things that a museum has to do. And I suppose my kind of days of horror when I thought, what am I doing? Why am I worrying about chips? Coming out the other side from that, I do increasingly recognise that this is all linked. That ultimately, the recognition of the role of enterprise, communications, facilities management, audience engagement within a museum strengthens and supports programming, the key reason why we all do what we do. They can release resources and importantly ensure the programs that we all care so much about have impact and reach people. And as I say, keeping that balance where one doesn't dominate the other, and I think where it's very clear within the organization why you do different things. The thing we found very important in the IFI is to always come back to that model of cross-subsidy. We need to think about burgers and toilets in order that we can subsidize and protect our program. A simple equation, but you need to keep that to the fore. And I'm going to end with one of my favorite images, people queuing around the block to get into the IFI. Now, I have to confess, this was, and actually that was 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning as well, which makes it even more impressive. But that was an open day when we were giving away free tickets for the day. So it's a slightly misleading image. But having said that, even though it was free tickets for the day, it was for films that perhaps people otherwise might not normally see. We had Make Way for Tomorrow that day, which was something. This is something we do annually. We have a day where we open up the museum, open up the IFI to, in a very kind of free way. That we show 14 films a day. There are a lot of events running in the building during the day. The tickets are given out on a first come first serve basis. But crucially, the films we program are films that we really want to encourage people to watch. So, for example, on that day, people were queuing to see My Night with Maud, Make Way for Tomorrow, an extraordinary film from 1937 that had never been seen in Ireland before, to Gremlins, to rare archive films that we were showing from the Irish Film Archive. So, as I say, it's slightly jokey image to finish with, and maybe that's what we're all aiming towards as the audience is queuing around the block. But in thinking about how an organisation can balance all those different aspects and the many hats that we can wear and filter that kind of energy and filter that focus towards really the ultimate aim of supporting our programmes and getting people to enjoy them. Thank you.